Okay, now what we're starting is video number 8, which goes over vitamins, minerals, and herbs. And just as a little bit of introduction here as far as some of the definitions, before we get in here, a lot of times you're going to get people in to your nursing homes, to your assisted living, that have been living at home, and because they've been on a fixed income, they haven't been eating very well. And they didn't have the money to buy a lot of fresh vegetables, a lot of fresh fruits, meats, milks, very expensive. So they could be in a condition of hypovitamintosis or avitamintosis, a condition that results in just simply a deficiency or a lack of vitamins for different reasons. Now, when it comes to vitamins, you have two major groups. You have fat soluble and water soluble. The fat soluble are A, D, E, and K. The water soluble are the B's, and there's several of them, the B's and C. The difference is the fat soluble can be stored and build up in the fat cells, the adipose tissue, the fat cells of your body. The B's and C's normally are not. Once you reach a level of intake of what your body needs for that day, you basically get rid of the rest of it. So like I said, your fat solubles are your A, D, E, and K. Your water solubles are your B complex, your B vitamins, and then of course C. They're soluble in water, so they're going to be leaving your body. Hypervitamintosis, hypovitamintosis, well, you can probably figure out what that is, of course. Hypo meaning low vitamins, hyper meaning high vitamins. Because it is possible we will see diseases, we will see symptoms, we will see problems with either one of these. Hyper or low vitamins or hyper high vitamins. Because that is basically homeostasis, balance. You know, in just about another month, the Olympic Games are going to be starting. And one of the events of the Summer Olympics is that balance beam, where the ladies get up and they have a 4-inch board that they flip on and jump on and do somersaults on and do all this stuff. But if they go to a little bit too far to the left or a little bit too far to the right, they fall off. Well, that is the same way with so much of our meds. Too little, a person doesn't get better. Too much, a person could have some really dangerous side effects. And definitely the same here is with vitamins. A lot of times people have too little, they have symptoms, signs and symptoms. They have too much, they could have signs and symptoms of excess. So that, of course, is hypo or hypervitamintosis. We also, when we talk about vitamin, minerals, and herbs, we have to talk about macro and micro minerals. The macro minerals are the ones that our body needs about 100 milligrams a day of. The micro minerals are those minerals that our daily requirements are 100 milligrams or basically less than 100 milligrams. And so we know about vitamins, we know about minerals, and of course our source for most of these is the food we eat. If you have the book by chance, on 169, you'll basically see what's called my pyramid. It's what the FDA suggests of how many servings a person take of grains, vegetables, fruits, milk, and meats and beans, you know, every day. I can't remember if this was Socrates or Plato, but I've been told that one of those Greek philosophers made an astounding statement. And what they said was medicine, food is our medicine, medicine is our food. And they were realizing back then the role, the important role for human growth and development that foods played. Now, did they know about the vitamins? Did they know about the the macro minerals, the micro minerals, the fat, water, salt, no, probably not. But they just knew that food played an important role. And a lot of times, you know, we do have people with avitamintosis and different issues that can really, really cause a lot of disturbances to the body. Now, on the outline under 7, for B, basically, you know, talk about electrolytes being next. Now, the sodium and potassium, we've already talked about with the cardiac system, that when your heart contracts, sodium goes into your heart cells. Then when your heart relaxes, sodium comes out and potassium goes in. That is what plays the vital role of the resting phase of the heart. So you can imagine especially what's going to happen to someone, potentially or probability, what's going to happen to someone if they get their potassium out of balance. That resting phase of the heart is going to really be hampered. So when we're talking about some of the different minerals and macro minerals that we have in our body, I kind of just want to go through just some of the different vitamins and some of the different things here and talk about what their function is. Source, I'm not going to talk so much about that, but a little bit. And I'm going to talk about symptoms of deficiency and symptoms of excess, okay? Because this is why a lot of times you're going to be giving these supplements, why you're going to be giving a multiple vitamin, why you're going to be giving iron or ferrous sulfate, why you're going to be giving Oscal or calcium with vitamin D, you know? Because of some of these things are lacking in the person's diet, and because of this, they're having some of these manifestations. So, vitamin A, it helps the skin basically form. It also helps maintain skin and healthy integrity. It also helps bone growth, development of teeth. Vitamin A does help with the immune system. Of course, the immune system is our system that fights off diseases, and vitamin A helps with vision. So if it helps with all those things, you could almost imagine immediately what's going to be some of the symptoms of deficiency. Night blindness, rough skin, lack of bone growth, and maybe susceptibility to infections. Sources are mostly milk, whole milk, eggs, products, green leafy vegetables, and yellow fruits. Some of the symptoms of excess of vitamin A are nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and in rare cases, liver damage. Vitamin D maintains healthy bones and teeth. We get it sunlight, fortified milk, dairy products, fish, liver oil. Symptoms of deficiency, of course, if it helps with the bones, are going to be weak bones. Excess, nausea, vomiting, anorexia. Vitamin E, it helps, it prevents the oxidation of fatty acids. Vitamin E is real popular today, you know, along with the omega-3, you know, and the vitamin E. In cardiac patients that, or even past stroke patients that have had strokes or heart attacks due to fat clots, because it does, you know, prevent oxygenation of fatty acids. So it's in our vegetable oils, our green leafy vegetable oils. Symptoms of deficiency, it could break down, a person could break down red blood cells. And of course, red blood cells are really important, because that's what carries oxygen throughout our body. Symptoms of excess, of course, could be increased bleeding for a person. And then vitamin K helps with what's called prothrombin, and which is the ability to clot blood, you know. So you know, a little cut doesn't turn into a massive cut. So when it helps with this prothrombin time, you know, a person is not going to hemorrhage. But if a person's low on vitamin K, they could hemorrhage. They could bleed. If they have too much of it, they could form blood clots. Because that's the whole thing about life. It's a balance. Like I said, the balance beam. Too much of one, too little of another, and basically a person could fall off. Fall off of what? Life, you know? So here again with K, vitamin K, too little they hemorrhage, too much they could form blood clots. Now, in our macro minerals, we have calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium, and phosphorus. The two that I talk about the most, like I said, are sodium and potassium because of the role that they play in the heart. So we've already talked about that quite a bit. Now, in our minerals, like I said, we have the micro minerals and we have the macro minerals. The macro minerals, what I just, you know, stated, the calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium, phosphorus. In the micro minerals, iron, iodine, zinc, copper. Now, the one big one here that I talk about a lot, of course, is iron. You know, it forms hemoglobin. Iron helps us form hemoglobin, which is the part of the red blood cell that actually carries our oxygen. So we can imagine if a person is low on iron, they're going to probably have an anemia issue. And because of that, they're going to be weak, they could be short of breath, and they could have many issues because of lack of oxygen. Sources are liver, lean meats, legumes, whole grains, dark green vegetables, and eggs. And signs of excess, nausea, vomiting, and like was stated earlier, iron can cause the stools to turn black and tarry. Iodine is another micro mineral. It is a major component for the thyroid gland and the production of the thyroid hormone. Now the thyroid hormone gives, and we'll talk more about this in the endocrine system again, I'm sure, but the thyroid hormone gives you energy. You have several things that give you energy. Sugar gives you energy when it's metabolized and bonds with insulin. The result of that is energy. Thyroid also gives you energy. And so if a person, and what builds, what assists the thyroid gland to do this is iodine. We need a little bit of iodine for our thyroid gland. If we're not getting that, we could very well be hypothyroid. And if we are hypothyroid, we're basically going to have low energy, low endurance, low energy. And just not physical energy, but the energy to make our heart beat, the energy to make our brain operate, our kidneys, our lungs to basically function. Now, if we go hyperthyroid, then of course at that point, that's going to be too much energy. When we get to the endocrine system, we'll talk about more about Synthroid and that medication. But right now, we're on the micro mineral iodine and that, like what the role that it plays for basically the thyroid gland to produce thyroxin and the hormones. Now, a lot of people take a lot of common herbs, okay? And there could be potentially some interference with the herbs that they're taking and the prescription medicines that you're giving. Now, these aren't true with everybody. These are just potentials. And I want to read off a couple of these, okay? Aloe vera, people take it, you know, for an anti-inflammatory, but it could interfere. And again, this is all potentials. It could interfere with Diabeta and Micronase, which are diabetic meds. So it could interfere with those meds working for somebody. There's other ones here, like garlic, for instance. A lot of people use that, you know, for high cholesterol, they say, or for blood pressure. That could interfere with persantin, which is still a cardiac med today that helps with the blood flow, so people aren't so prone to basically make blood clots. Garlic could potentially interfere with Coumadin, which is a medication used a lot today for a person that's had a past stroke or a past heart attack. It's a very used blood thinner today. Ginkgo biloba is used a lot. There's a potential it could interfere with some of these meds: aspirin, Celexa, Prozac, Glucotrol, Diabetum, Micronace, used a lot for diabetes control. Haldol, of course, that is an antipsychotic used for controlling behavior. Glucophage, another diabetic medication. Paxil, Zoloft, a couple more of our antidepressants. And then some of our diuretics, it could interfere with how they work. And then Coumadin, the blood thinner. So here we have this ginkgo biloba that the person is taking for different thoughts or different reasons, for dementia or Alzheimer's, you know, hoping that it helps there, but it could be interfering with some of these other meds that they're taking to control their diabetes, or to control the amount of water, the diuretic they're taking, the thiazide diuretic, trying to pull off extra water from the blood to lower their blood pressure. So it could interfere with that. And again, Coumadin, it could interfere with Coumadin. And here again, that's Coumadin is trying to prevent blood clots from happening. So that could possibly bother a person. Golden Seal, used sometimes people use it and buy it for an anti-inflammatory. Well, it could interfere with a couple of antibiotics, vibromycin, tetracycline. And of course, these are strong antibiotics, and doctors use them, prescribe them for really strong infections. So here the person could be taking something that literally could mess up this working of the antibiotics. St. John's wort, used a lot for mild depression and things like that. Some of the things it can interfere with. And again, these are just potentials. So what do you need to do? Watch for potential interferences. If these medicines that I'm listing are not working well, not doing their job, they're not giving the therapeutic effect that you want to see for your residents, and they're taking some of these things, that probably needs to be reported on, because it could be interfering with the use, with the purpose of the prescription med. But St. John's wort can interfere with some chemotherapy drugs. It can interfere with Paxil, Zoloft, Nardil, some of the meds used for depression. Theophylline, well, that's a med for the lungs, for somebody who's having a hard time breathing. It's a bronchodilator. So maybe that's the reason why they're not breathing so well. It's because the St. John wort is interfering with the theophylline, and, you know, so maybe they're not getting worse with their lung disease. It's simply that medicine's being antagonistic toward it, or not really medicine. St. John's was not technically a medicine, not a prescription, it's over the counter, of course, but you know what I meant, what they're taking, the component of it. And not, again, I stress, this isn't a given, these are potentials, so we gotta watch for it. And then again, Coumadin. Now, some of the herbs that people actually take today, they hear it from a friend, they take it on late night TV, these are the ones that are unsafe. And some of these are really unsafe. Now, there's several of these that I honestly don't know, I've not heard of, but the one that I have heard people taking is sassafras. They use it as a stimulant, an anti-arthritic medication, and it contains carcinogenic agents. Carcinogenic means cancer, so it contains carcinogenic agents, so that could actually be very detrimental to somebody's health. Some of the other unsafe herbs, are borage. People take it as an anti-diarrheal, but it again contains toxic chemicals. Colt's foot is another one. People use it for coughs. It contains toxic chemicals. Ephedra, of course, now this one you have probably heard of. You know, people take it for a central nervous stimulant. Well, it can be extremely dangerous in people with hypertension and diabetes, because what it can do with either one of these people is raise the blood pressure incredibly high or raise the blood sugar incredibly high. And of course, you know what happens to a person that the blood pressure goes high, stroke or heart attack. And then there's another one here, poke root. It's kind of in some magazines or late night TV may be advertised as being used for an anti-cancer med. Well, it's basically fatal in children. So some of these herbs are very dangerous. So what you're going to need to do is probably once in a while check with your residents, your clients, and just kind of review them with them on a social basis. Are there any medications, and again I use the word medications, but any of the pills, over-the-counter, herbs, anything that a friend has brought into them, or they heard about on late night TV or read about in a magazine that this will help you with this? Because a lot of people that have these chronic illnesses, a lot of times are desperate. Alzheimer's, congestive heart failure, diabetes, cancer. They hear something and they're desperate, and they will buy it and they will try it. But they don't know what you know about all the interferences it could be doing in their medicines, or even some of these fatal toxic ones. So what I'm saying is, once in a while, you need to visit with them and just ask them, are you taking any other medicines or any other pills or any other liquids or any other, you know, use a language that they'll understand. And they may consider this a medicine, even though you're not. So maybe even use that word. Are they taking anything else that is added to their daily regimen that you're not aware of? And if it is, you're probably going to need to get that information to the pharmacy, and they are going to need to cross-reference it with their meds and see, is there any antagonistic event that could happen from these? Or is there something in this that is toxic or even fatal to them? And to kind of review it. Okay, this, you know, ends it for vitamins, minerals, and herbs. We talked about the different vitamins, the fat-soluble A, D, E, and K, and what too little or too much can do for a person.